Hello, my name is Dr. Imaginous. I'm not a doctor, I just play one here on YouTube, TikTok, and Facebook. Here's today's download. Today's download is a topic that, I have to bear my vast library arsenal. My huge fourth grade education to bear, and I wanted to analyze a book that I love and we all love dearly, and it's called Horton Hears a Who. Yeah, this book is over 70 years old. It's probably been read to everybody at some point in their lives, and we all know the message. So that's why I have decided to review this video that Dr. Seuss had made the story in the 50s, and the video was produced in the 70s. Okay, so in the 70s, when this video was produced, I mean, it was a really liberal awakening. Free speech was, being challenged even back then. But society was so against the old school, It was the old guard, the good old boys, the GOP network and stuff that was the political atmosphere at the time when this video was made. So the correlation I'm trying to make is that when they were making this video, everything was really tipsy-turvy, okay? In the 70s, we still had the Vietnam War going on. A lot of civil rights was going on. You had Charles Manson going on. There was a lot of unrest, but this show was still produced and it was still a good message. I didn't find out until Dr. Pepper did some research for me and he informed me that Dr. Seuss, the original author, was a political cartoonist during the Second War. He did documentaries, stuff like that. I didn't realize this because when I watched this show, for some reason, my Imaginus kept throwing this in my face when I tried to ignore it because I'm like, Dr. Seuss and Horton Hears a Who, it's not really what I want to talk about. So I re-watched the video, and oh my goodness, when I watched the video, I realized the same kind of atmosphere when this video was produced is kind of playing out right now. And I kind of made a weird kind of comparison, and I don't know how to even explain this one, but the comparison, excuse me, the comparison that I made was Nostradamus predicting the future and Horton Hears a Who. This doesn't make sense. But after I watched Nostradamus predicts things way in the future. Horton Hears a Who and Dr. Seuss, I think, was just aware of the political atmosphere that was going on. And I just feel like it's so relevant to today's society to take a look at this simplified video. It's not a bunch of rapping and not a bunch of ass shaking, and it's none of that. It's Dr. Seuss. Okay, let's get into it. Let's watch Horton Hears a Who. A speck of dust next to a butterfly is my first stop, okay? Because I just want everybody to imagine this moment on this video, free butterfly, just a speck of dust floating in the air. Isn't that what we kind of are in the atmosphere, you know, in our planet? Just a speck of dust. I feel like that's my Imaginus in my head. Just that little tiny thing, and it's weird.
Because after all, a person's a person, no matter how small.
That's a cool saying. A person is a person, no matter how small. Powerful words. Horton is just a nice guy. Just a nice guy. He doesn't mean no harm to nobody. I feel like this is part of our society, how we... Horton thinks he hears something, and all these naysayers, you know, start out the gate with no evidence at all, but they're going to already make conclusions. I find this fascinating. Some people just have instincts to protect and watch over people. I don't know what to say, but I feel like these are kind of like police officers and stuff, you know? The kids that we grew up in school with that you probably never thought would ever be a police officer, but if you ever think back at school, they probably were helping people or keeping people safe or something like that, if you really look into it. I bet you'd find more than not. Just saying. The science is trying to make a breakthrough. You have your scientists and stuff, and it's always a naysay in the science community until it's proven. And that's the way it should be. Science is science. But it has to be proven, and it has to be facts. Because it's not science unless it's proven science. And just not to a conclusion doesn't make it science. It's science in the works, okay? So I could see a correlation where this WHO doctor is, you know, he's, you know, trying to create science for his people, but they're not believing him. And they're just going about their business. It takes catastrophic incidences to wake people up. And then they all look to the science community for the answers. Well, here we are in this pandemic looking to our scientists, and everything's getting cloudy. The science isn't clear because you have two opposing factions on this. And most times in science, you have two opposing factions on almost every thing science comes down to. But here we are again, battling science from two different directions instead of trying to come up with one.
I am Dr. H. Hoovy, professor of science. I've worked 50 years on my WHOscope appliance to prove to the people who live in this place there are worlds beyond ours, like yours, out in space. But the people down here don't believe me. They don't.
That's perfectly right, Doc. We don't and we won't.
That doctor kind of reminds me of Elon Musk, because at the beginning of his trying to go to space, I mean, they laughed at him. And
I don't like to fuss up.
Poor Elon Musk. he don't know. I think that's funny. Hollywood. The gossip in Hollywood. This is Hollywood. Someone would say something, then someone would say something, and it would get totally lost in translation, just like it does now, but at a rapid speed.
He's cracked.
And that's probably what y'all think of me. Little bird that's cracked. That looks like they're all attacking his heritage. His Horton has no way to change what he is. He's an elephant, but they're attacking him, his family tree, everything. So this is kind of a weird correlation right here where Horton is getting ready to sneeze. So when I look at that little clover, weird, it reminds me of a COVID thing, a COVID particle. It's going to rain pickles and it's going to pour soap. That's weird. Misinformation. That's really kind of how I feel the elite is treating us now, where they just look down their glasses at us, look over their glasses down their nose. I think that's where our government is right now, and that's a sad thing to say. I mean, it just seems like it's such a political atmosphere and so unnecessary. Because if you look at this simple video about Horton, pretty much everybody just wants to be by themselves and chillax. But you have a few people that have this power have nothing to do. They don't have real jobs. They don't have to go work for a living. They could sit there in their ivory towers and look down their opera glasses at us all. I feel that. Those three people remind me of those, like, three lady Congress ladies that are always saying some really bizarre stuff. Look at that. That is what our political atmosphere looks like to me. I bet it looks that way to a lot more than just me. But this is a perfect representation of what's happening in our government right now. Sad but true. They're silencing him because you're not going to be talking to no more Who's. We're going to silence you. We're going to take your platform away. Basically, they're taking the whole communication away from Horton. By taking it from him, I mean, obviously, they're taking it from him, but it's the same. They're taking free speech away, their free thought, free everything, and the contempt on their face and the satisfaction that they have and the power that they've possessed in this moment is some of the same kind of expressions that I notice on some of our politicians. They shut down his Twitter. So that black bottom eagle, to me, represents the mainstream media. Heidi high, heidi ho, let us play hide and seek. He let that clover stop and fall in the abyss of disinformation. This could go any way, any place, any, wow. I mean, think about it. This is our whole, this is like, we're living this little cartoon.
Side.
If that doesn't seem like the mainstream media or the legacy media now referred to as, I don't know what is.
With a flip of his black bottom tail.
So, I love this part because Horton is at a crossroads, and for this little elephant to look at that daunting challenge, that daunting challenge is absolutely amazing. When he has to, when he looks over the top of that and he sees that sea of despair, I mean, to me, that could break the best of us. Again, this little show has so many different elements and angles to it that I just love the way Dr. Seuss was able to analyze the political atmosphere that he was living in, and then pretty much analyze it again 60 years later and come up with the same conclusion. Or has the same conclusion been the same for all that time? Has it been this way and we never really noticed it until COVID came, until it opened our eyes? Were we just in a fog as Americans and living underneath this slowly moving tyranny swing, like continents moving across the Atlantic? It's just a slow move. And it's so slow, we don't recognize it until something catastrophic happens, like say an earthquake, you know, and or a pandemic. That's kind of what I'm thinking, you know. It's just a slow crawl and then a snap. I digress again because this thing takes me to a lot of different angles. Horton spends all that time, all that energy, all that work trying to find his clover. I mean, I think this was really powerful when I was a little boy, when I did hear this story, because it was a story of you don't give up. You keep fighting. You keep, if you have something that you believe in so much, to pick a clover by clover, I mean, it just says that if you believe in something, you need to go for it. So I think this is what separates a lot of believers and non-believers in themselves, this kind of moments, because when you're up against a daunting task like, you know, 10 billion clovers and whatever it is, and you work your way through it, try to work your way through it. You may not even get through it, but at least you tried. These are the building moments that I don't think we're getting to our kids anymore. I don't think these moments are explained well enough that we have to dig in to be successful in life in general. And we have to stay vigilant and focused. Huh, that's not me. This is where I started really getting emotional, because I felt like this is when the pandemic kind of hit Whoville. And no one was ready for it, you know, no one was prepared for it. So after the pandemic came, everybody was like, we believe in the doctor, we believe in the doctor, you know. And so this is where we're at as a society, you know. We want to believe as a people that our leaders are leading us not into an ambush, but out of an ambush. But we're not getting led out of an ambush. It feels like we're getting led into a bigger ambush. It's just a slow crawl, just a slow movement against democracy in the slowest of continental drifts. And it's just, but it got amplified. It got way amplified during COVID. No one saw it coming. We never saw China's coming down in our rearview mirror like we do now. We didn't see that stuff coming because it was a slow drift, like I say. The whole population of Whoville is scared now, and they're looking to their leaders and scientists for answers. Unfortunately, in the real world, we didn't get the great advice that this Doctor Who is going to give his people. It was straightforward, precise, to get it right, and they only had one shot. But he did what he had to do to make sure that his people survived. The very first thing that she wants to do is rope and cage Horton for speaking his mind or his imagination or what? You know? I mean, wow. Straight out the gate. No court of laws in there, you know, nothing. I mean, it's straight to the ouch. When you look at this part where they're all coming towards Horton, he's backed up over a cliff, you know, and the whole political party is coming after him, and it's just him. And I feel like the Canadians are kind of the Who's right now, because it seems like Who's are really good, nice, gentle people, and we all know the Canadians are really nice, gentle people. So we are here, we are here. It seems to me that the Canadians are like trying to make their voices because they got a mandate. Now, Canada is our very kind neighbors to the north, and I believe if you upset Canada, then you pretty much upset some pretty down-to-earth people. It's the topic of our times, you know, but we have to stay vigilant to keep our society free, because if we don't, this is our fate. All those truckers, all those, they're going to cage them up. They're going to, I mean, take their basic needs of water and fuel. It's 10 degrees and they're not going to give them fuel. If those trucks dry up, diesel fuel at this temperature, pretty tough. To almost impossible without a lot of effort to get them fired back up. So starving them out on fuel would be a bad move because it would actually make it worse for them if there was any kind of resolution to this and it was peaceful, which we all hope it is peaceful. The threatening of shutting down the internet, I think, is kind of laughable in its own way, because when you think about it, truckers have CBs. They could communicate amongst themselves. So I believe this kind of represents a little bit of our younger generation today. They got all this chaos running around, and I'm talking about our, 15 to 24 year olds. I believe not all of them. I mean, my kids are that age. So, but I believe this is kind of the mentality that they have fallen into as kids, because this particular lesson in life kind of lost in translation. When you tell a story from one person to the next person, it loses something as it goes on. That's why I'm here to refresh it, because I mean, it's a great story. It's a great correlation to what's happening in our society today, written 70 years ago, put to film, 50 years ago. The one cool thing about Dr. Seuss, and if you look at this last little bit, he's telling everybody to blow on their kazoozle or their whatever, and the one other thing about Dr. Seuss is all those people are different colors and different shapes and different sizes, and not two are the same, which I find absolutely fascinating in a world for children. This is why there's no colors, no distinctive races in here. They're all different. I mean, just because someone believes in something and the mainstream society does not believe in something, they want to boil them in oil. That's where we're at politically these days. Not literally boiling them in oil, but tar and feathering them, at least with cancel culture and everything. Ran out of town. Someone like Joe Rogan being, trying to tar and feather him, I mean, that's exactly what it was, what it's. People, look at your history. Look at your history. Wow. Okay, let's see what this little kid does.
Can't you, Gob?
I just don't know, sir. I never have tried.
Well, what the fuck? You better try soon. Or you're gonna be fried.
Look at him. I mean, you have to look at the atmosphere of this cartoon right now. You got all these people screaming one thing. You got the Whoville, trying to preserve their life.
And then undecisiveness.
I think
I'll try a yeah.
Poor Horton.
Yeah. Yeah.
So this is the yop. This is my yop to y'all. Alright? It's just a yop because I am just, I'm not Horton, I'm not a who, I'm the yop. I'm not the little kid in there, I'm none of that. All I am is this little four-letter word, yop. And that's how I feel. I'm trying to break out.
That yop, that one small extra yop, put it over. Finally, at last, from that speck on that clover, their voices were heard.
So, when they did finally hear the yop, everything is like a huge relief. All of a sudden, oh, wow, it is true. And look at the joy on
ringing clear through the air.
They are there.
So, I mean, it's just a beautiful story. I don't think that we can get everybody to be like Horton and his crew. But the message is what I'm interested in. And the message is that, you know, we go through some tough times, man. And, you know, we have to make other people believe in what we're doing if we want to make a impact. And not everybody wants to make an impact. Some people just want to be left alone, and I get that. But we have to really take a look at all our little things that we're doing as a society. And it's just coming from a very simple mind, me. But this video is so, wow, it's trying to make the correlation from 70 years to now. I see so many similarities in it that it just is amazing. So they're going to lock Horton up. They found out that they had heard the Who's, and they were going to boil him and cage Horton. And I feel like this is where the truckers are right now. And I'm hoping it ends up in the same scenario that the politicians that are dragging these truckers down this path to, like, cage them, silence them, do everything, that the Who's of Canada, the Who's of Canada are going to make enough noise to not let these truckers be assaulted, because all they're asking for is their freedom of expression, freedom of choice, freedom of tyranny. And if not, they're willing to fight. And Horton is a nice elephant, but he's still an elephant. Truckers are nice, but they're still in trucks. These are, you know, I'm sure you think about getting an elephant upset. If Horton was really upset, he could do some damage, but he's a nice guy. So you Canadians need to think about this. And if you upset Horton, too bad. Let's see what happens. Let's finish.
The people had spoken, no matter how small. And their whole world was saved by the smallest of all.
Yes. Yep. So that's pretty cool. Yes. 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 So that's the end of this reaction video. Normally reaction videos aren't about Dr. Seuss, but the message in this is 100% about our society and everything that's happening now. I see the correlation. Maybe nobody else does, but, you know, I think if you absolutely take the time to watch this little video, it will open up your eyes a little bit and bring back that little kid in your inner self, and you will see the message that this is bringing and how important it is for us all to understand what's going on. But anyways, that's it. That's the message I wanted to talk to about. Horton hears a Who. Feels like the Who's are Canadians, because I think they're the nicest people on the planet. As a race, as a country, I should say. So that's my video today. I hope you like it. I encourage everybody to watch it. It's great. And don't be canceling Dr. Seuss. He didn't do nothing. And he's also a doctor that's playing a doctor that really isn't a doctor. So signing out. Have a great day.
I imagine you liked this video. So follow me and subscribe to my channel. Share with your friends and neighbors. I'm Dr. Imaginous, reminding you to always follow your imagination.